Good morning, good morning. We are going to continue on with missions reports. Today we have Portland, and we have the group that went to Dallas. And Dallas is going to start us first. So if Mrs. Maka and that group want to come on up, come on up, come on up.
Good morning. How are y'all today? We had, you know, it was a perfect trip, in my opinion. It was just a great, great trip. And I loved getting to know these fellow teachers better. And Miss Hayslip and I think we're twins and we just didn't know it. We have a lot in common. And anyway, it was just really good from that respect. And these kids were awesome. And, you know, God just took care of even little things before we went. This is a huge team of kids. And the neat thing about the organization we were working with in Dallas, they're called Kaleo, and they had us busy all day long. But they needed our kids in three different groups because they're involved with several different ministries in Dallas. And so that ministered to the homeless. So we needed our kids in three groups. Well, that meant we needed three modes of transportation. And we took the big bus. But it was so cool because God worked that out because baseball drove two vans, parked them in Dallas while they went to Bogota? Dominican Republic, excuse me. Anyway, and so we were able to use those vans. And then we returned them on Thursday when we were finished. And they flew in on Thursday and then came home. So that worked out really great. Miss Hayslip and I had to drive the vans from where they were parked to where we were going. It was raining. I was pulling a trailer, and I was in a great big van, and I got lost because this semi would not let me over. And he was very mean, and so I went over anyway. And because I knew that I had to keep up with the bus, and so I'd know where to go. Well, I lost sight of him. So I just said, okay, God, I'm just going to pull off. I'm just going to exit, and I'm going to sit. I'm going to call them and tell them, come get me. So I park, and I call my husband. I said, you're going to talk to me on the phone here until somebody comes and gets me. And so anyway, but you know what? I had exited right where I was supposed to. I mean, I was like a minute from the church where we were staying. So God was just so good. And my particular little group had a great time making fun of my driving all week. I'm not used to big old long vans, so I did hit just about every curb in Dallas. And you know what? There's just this nice, nice young man named Yan Fei, who I've just always thought's the nicest thing. And he gave me a harder time than anybody about hitting the curbs. But anyway, it was a great trip. We had a lot of fun. But we did work with this organization called Kaleo, and what they do is they come in and they work for organizations that are already established in Dallas. And so I think we worked with, six different organizations? And so our teams would do one thing in the morning, and then they might do something else in the afternoon. And, you know, they switched and went different places. So it changed it up a lot, and which was great for our kids because they got all kinds of different experiences. They served food to the homeless in a great big shelter where we were. My group actually worked with kids every afternoon in that big shelter. Handed out clothes for homeless people that came. We even went on one day a search and rescue mission where you get in a van and you literally, I mean, they drive around looking for homeless people and then they stop and, you know, talk to them and offer them you know, food and water and stuff. And that was definitely a challenge, you know, just going up to somebody on the street and talking to them like that. But that was a great experience as well. And the thing that I really liked about these organizations, you know, I had someone ask me when I came back, when I was telling them about our trip, they said, doesn't all that enable these people to continue a homeless lifestyle? I mean, they've got food, they've got clothing, they've got somewhere to stay. Those that choose to go to the shelter, there's a lot that like to stay on the street. And but the neat thing about these organizations is they require their people to get training to become self-sufficient. And so they have to take, you know, they have to get their GED if they do not have it. They have to do, you know, learn interviewing skills and have to become gainfully employed so that they don't remain homeless. So several of the kids want to share with you about what they did. Coach Hofstetter does too. And so I'm going to pass the microphone to him.
You go ahead.
Okay. I'll be quick. I'm just going to share a verse. This is what was kind of on my mind all week for the students. I think the leaders would agree with me that not only did we experience this, but we kind of saw this change in the students. And I'll let them talk more about what they actually did. But it comes from Luke when Jesus was a child and his parents had left him. And then they found him learning in the temple. And it said that Jesus grew in wisdom and stature and in favor with God and man. And that was kind of something that stuck in my mind all week as I watched my group work. And how they changed and how they grew throughout the week. And I think I can honestly say, and I think the leaders would too, that I saw growth from our students in their minds and then in their favor with God and man as well. And so that was kind of the big point in how I would sum up our experience in a nutshell as far as what we were able to accomplish and then how it affected the students. So I'll let them tell you more about what they did. Josh, I think you're up first.
Okay. Basically what we did, we had to split up into three groups since we were so big. Our group went to Our Calling, Melting Pot, and what else? It was three organizations.
Dallas Life Foundation.
And Dallas Life. And basically the things that we did was we fed the homeless, talked to them, and then we also, at the Melting Pot, we played with kids, refugee kids, and taught them and did songs and stuff like that. And we also put up sheetrock, which was fun too, with Mike. It was just a good experience and a lot of stuff. But the thing that hit me the most was at Our Calling, and the guy, it was a homeless foundation and stuff, and the guy said most of the people that were there were homeless because they didn't listen to their parents, which was kind of a main thing that hit me, because I don't like to listen to my parents that much, but, you know, it all works out. So
I was in his group, so I'm going to talk a little bit more about the sheetrock experience. It was a bit rough. We got to hang out with this guy named Mike, and he really didn't know how to hang up sheetrock. We found out he was Googling it right before we did it. It was a bit stressful. Instead of putting, like, four perfect squares on a wall, we ended up putting three triangles, four rectangles, and two trapezoids. Not a good experience.
Well, pass it down.
Okay, so, like, I was in the same group. So when we went to the refugee kids, it was really cool because, like, going around and seeing all them, like, when we went up to their apartments to go get the kids, it was really kind of, like, hit me because they don't have very much. And so it was just kind of like, just showed me that I need to be like grateful for what I have and what they don't have, because they were really happy for what they had.
Oh yeah, I was in Miss Maka's group, and she was not lying about the curb thing. It was terrifying. but we worked the first day with Our Calling, and that search and rescue thing that we did was actually really cool. We got to meet a lot of interesting people, and it was cool to see, you know, hear their stories and how they live life, and it really taught me a lot.
Okay, so I got to play with the kids most of the week, and that was awesome. My little friend's name was Taranisha. She's my friend. And so she's just really fun. And I just got to connect with her on a level of friendship, and it was really great. So okay.
Okay. So I was in the group that went to the refugee place, and the guy that was in charge of it, his name was Mike, and he had a grandson named Jackson, and we thought he was, like, totally normal, like, and he loved us being there. Like, he was happy that we were just cleaning out a storage, like, just happy that we were there. And Ms. Hayslip told us that night that his mom's an alcoholic, and his grandpa was trying to get custody of him. And so, like, when we left, it was really hard for him because no one, like, cares about him that much. And so it just kind of showed me that even though he's not homeless, he still has problems, and that to take into consideration that just because people may not be on the street or not in the best situations, that they still have problems.
All right, guys. So one of the things I learned is we went to Urban Action, which was like a little, like, the lady rented an apartment and held like a kind of like a VBS, but she did it every day. And they were telling us about it before we went, and they're like, yeah, guys, she's a missionary from South Africa to America. And I was like, oh, no. All right. So I learned that service is really important, and I don't have to go out of the city, I don't have to go out of the state, and I don't have to go out of the country to serve, because there are obviously people who need service and, well, like, help in America just as much, because there's a missionary from South Africa going to America. Yeah.
Okay, one thing that I learned is, like, the very beginning at Dallas Life, we are working with these little kids and stuff like that, and they were, like, crazy. They were off the walls, like, throwing fits because they didn't get the right color that they wanted, and it was bad. And so one thing that I learned from that is it's not about us. It's like, we didn't pray when we walked in. We didn't, like, focus our eyes on trying to teach these kids. We were more worried about, like, okay, let's get this day done and let's go on. Let's go to our next event. And that was one reason why that day didn't really work out, because we didn't really plan ahead and ask God to lead the way and stuff like that.
I played with the kids most of the time, and they just picked on me a ton. They, like, pulled my hair and stuff. So I guess I learned how to deal with kids, basically. I mean, it's basically all I got, so.
And that's our trip. It was a great time, and we encourage any junior hires to really consider coming to Dallas next year if it's an option for you guys. It's a great learning experience.
Let me just say something about the kids, though, really quick. One thing that I just really kept saying to my group, because, y'all, we had some interesting children that we were working with. There was this little fellow named Saul. He was just a big bully. He was 4 years old. He was a great basketball player, but, I mean, any little two-year-old on the playground that had a ball, he would grab it from him and just push him down. And so I told him, I said, if you do that again, we're going to have to sit out and not play. So he had to sit out and not play. And this is what he told me. He said, you stupid. And then he said, you stupid and you's ugly. And I said, thank you. I am just the way God made me. And anyway, so he had to sit out, and then he went and played. But anyway, I told my kids, I said, these children, you know, the Bible tells us we're supposed to love children, and these kids are a product of their upbringing. They haven't been taught differently. And I hope that helped my children to see that they needed to love these kids anyway, no matter how they acted. Yes, it was fine to discipline them and make them sit out if they weren't behaving, but they did need to experience the fact that the reason they were difficult is because they don't know any better. And the kids did a great job of loving them anyway.
My group worked with homeless children every morning that week, and it was so hard because these kids don't have the structure or the love. And that's really where small children, we had kids from like 18 months old to like 11. And so we just saw, like Ms. Maka said, they're the product of their upbringing, and they're not loved at home, and they don't have the structure. And then we come in and we want to have the Bible story, and we want to do the memory verse, and we want to sing songs, and they were literally bouncing off the walls. And so our first day, like Katie said, was really hard because we were adapting to the environment and figuring out what kids we had. And then the next day day. Like, we came in with a plan. We were very dependent on the Lord every day to give us patience and strength and joy when kids are calling you names and kids are pushing other children. And so one thing that we really focused on was loving, and also loving them through discipline and being able to say to them, like, no, you're not going to climb on that table again and turn off the light switch. It's not going to happen. And when we did that, our kids felt more secure, and they felt more comfortable with us, and they knew the boundaries. And there was one little girl, and her name was Suri, and she was a handful. Yes, Saul's sister Suri. They were quite the pair. And the first day when I was with her, I was just all over her. Like, you can't pull hair, you can't push, you can't bite, you can't take toys, all of this stuff. And at the end of the day, I was just emotionally drained because I've been with this little preschooler all day long, giving her all these instructions, and just kind of drained from that. And the next day, as soon as we walked in, Suri saw me, and she ran up to me, and she threw her arms around my legs and wouldn't let go. And it was at that moment that I knew that I have to love her through discipline, because that's the type of love that she doesn't get at home. And that was hard, but I knew that it was beneficial to her. She did the exact same thing the next morning, and her mom looked at me and said, "What have you done with my kid?" And it just, I wanted to say to her, "I've just loved her. That's it." But that's so important for us to remember that loving people has such an impact on who they are, especially loving kids and loving these kids that are in hard places. So we learned a lot this trip. We all grew a lot. We got to see things that we've never seen before and do things that we've never done before. So it was a great trip. Raise your hand if this was your first mission trip. Yeah, so a great first mission trip experience, especially as freshmen. They got a taste of what it's like to serve and to serve locally in the U.S., and I think it gave them vision for what they can do in the coming years. So now to Portland.
Okay, teachers, chapel's going to go a little bit long today, so we're going to take the time that we need for Portland to share with you. Why don't I have my Portland group come on up here? To start with, we're going to start off with a slideshow. What's that? You want up on the stage or down here? So Portland, we worked with a similar, we actually worked with Kaleo Ministries as well in Portland, with the focus of being homeless outreach and then after school care, working with young kids after school. So it was kind of, our days were split up into two. But we have a slideshow that Mr. Buchanan graciously put together for us. So we'll start off with that, and then there's a couple of students that want to share. And then we have a video to close us out too. So why don't we go ahead and start that slideshow.
Some days life feels perfect, other days it just ain't working. The good, the bad, the right, the wrong, and everything in between. Yo, it's crazy, amazing, we can turn our heart through the words we say. Mountains crumble with every syllable, broken, live or die. So speak. Bye.
Okay, we were limited in some of the pictures that we could use because a number of the outreaches that we did, they asked us not to publicly use pictures with the kids because some of them were in shelters and they didn't want those pictures posted. So we were limited in some of what we could do. So we had a lot of donut pictures, but not as much with the kids. But that's the reason. We have pictures, we can't use them, and we want to respect those boundaries. But I want some of the students to share. Why don't you guys go ahead and stand up instead of sit down? Alex is going to share first.
Okay, I'll start us all off. Portland was an amazing trip. We had a really amazing group. The Holy Spirit worked a lot through this trip, and I'd say the amount of time we're allowed doesn't really do it justice. Well, it doesn't do any of these trips justice, but and I love the sound of my own voice. Y'all probably already know that, so I could go on for hours, but... I'll just give one anecdote real quick. One day when we were working down at one of the places we were handing out food, there was this guy. He was an older man. He had psoriasis, like, really bad. It was even on his face, which is super rare. He said his doctor said it was the worst case he had ever seen. But, you know, he wasn't the best-looking man. He didn't really respect personal space, poked me a lot. Every other sentence kind of spat on me, but... I talked to him for about an hour and a half. He had a really great story. And what he was saying was like, I really appreciate you taking this time to talk to me. I'm a really ugly guy, so lots of people, you know, try to look away. Then he like started pointing these people out and he was like, you know, those are the cool guys. Those are the polished guys. They have lots of friends. So it was really weird to see that even amongst like vagrants, they had their own social hierarchy. And you almost forget, like, they seem like such things in the background or nuisances, but they're people with social needs, and they just need someone to talk to. And, like, that's part of the reason why they're so frustrated.
Thank you, Alex. Okay, Sean and Kara are going to share an experience they had doing lunch ministry.
Okay, so this is my second year to go on this trip, and... I guess I was kind of a veteran, kind of, you can say. It was my second year. But, I kind of, Bullen put me in charge of, like, people that didn't really know what they were doing, like Kara. And like for those of you that know Kara, no, like it wasn't an insult or anything. Kara is super outgoing, but like I guess talking to strangers is kind of a hard thing to just walk up to somebody and ask them if they want a lunch. But she grew out of that real quick, and she has a good story to tell you.
Nope.
Yeah. She's really shy, but not.
Okay. So we went downtown Portland to like this park, and there's this guy. Well, we fed them lunch and stuff. We made them like sack lunches and stuff, and we just like pick random people that we wanted to go sit with or whatever. And there are these people on this bench, and me and Sean had walked. We already walked past them and stuff. And I was like, Sean, we should go back. And he was like, okay. So then we went back and kind of just sat with them. And there's these three guys, and one of them's name was Mike. And I started calling him Uncle Mike, and I didn't really know why. But we just kind of made a really big connection. And we started talking to them about life and stuff. And then I just got this really big connection with him. And I don't know, like, it was crazy. And then we left, and it just made me upset that we were leaving and stuff. And then we came back Thursday. And me and Sean were in the same group again, and we went back to their bench where they were sitting yesterday, and they weren't there. And we were really sad because we, like, see them all the time. And so we were really sad not to see them there. And as we were turning back around to go, like, find other people to, like, talk to and stuff. And when we turned around, we saw them across the park. And I, like, ran up to Uncle Mike. And I hugged him, and he, like, kissed me on the forehead. And he always called me, like, his granddaughter or something. And it was, like, a really big thing for me. And he had, like, a really sad story about his friend because he got hit by a car that morning. And we got to spend, like, that whole, like, 2 hours with him, like, as his friend was, like, dying. And, like, he was in surgery and stuff. And after he called up to the hospital when he got to the park, and he was, like, to see, like, how his friend was doing in surgery and stuff, and he found out that his friend wasn't going to make it, and so we got to be with him during that time, and that time he just, like, hugged me, and I don't know, it was just really special to me, and I started crying because it was just, like, an intense moment for me, and I don't know, and he, like, kissed me on the head all the time, calling me baby girl, honey, all this stuff, and it was just a really big thing for me, so, yeah.
Sweet time.
Sweat.
Mega bed.
It was a powerful moment. I was there with Kara and Sean, and it was a powerful moment. Colin is going to share about a story about after school program.
Okay. All right. So, by far, Portland was one of the most eventful weeks of my life. I found myself in situations looking at people lighting up crystal meth under a bridge, all the way to talking with a white supremacist ridden with tattoos about his heroin addiction. So, I mean, the most eventful thing that's happened to me in Lubbock in the past 6 months was I was driving back to my house from the school, and some sheet metal blew off of the Hooters next to Guitar Center and hit my car, and it scared me really bad. I digress. Anyways, so a lot of this crazy, evil stuff happened in Portland, but aside from that, we got to spend some time with these children at a children's ministry type thing. So so there was this one activity the children were supposed to do, and they were going to make a paper airplane, each of them, and see how far it traveled, and whoever's traveled the farthest was the winner. And so I decided I was going to partake in this competition. Most people say, man, Colin, you're so apathetic and lazy, and you're not competitive. But that's only because they've seen me in basketball. And I'm terrible at basketball. Coach Dykes can second me on that. He hated me. No, I'm kidding. At least I don't think he did. Anyways, I digress. And so I was really wanting to win this competition so badly to the point where I rubber banded a bunch of pencils together and stuck them in my paper airplane, so I was basically throwing a rock. So it was like, how far can you throw a rock? But of course, I didn't tell anybody this because I wanted to win. And so I was kind of hanging out with this kid named Alex. And, like, I was like, man, this kid, but he's going to lose so bad. This kid's a moron. Because what he had done to create his airplane, he had gotten a piece of paper and folded it in half. And then pointed the tip. So this kid's airplane was a piece of paper folded in half. And so I'm like, oh, this kid, oh, wow, what a moron. Like I'm gonna destroy this kid. And he then goes, I'm going to test my paper airplane. And Clayton and I are like, yeah, sure, kid. And so he stands up, and he goes over to the center of the classroom, and he just throws it down the middle. And this thing goes, like, all the way to the end of the room, hits the wall, and goes behind a bunch of tables and desks. And so I was really humiliated because it went further than my pencil cheating airplane. So there's really no moral to this story. I just thought I could share it.
It's about building relationship. You built relationship with that kid. Okay, Maddie's going to talk about Night Strike.
So the last night we got to go to this event under the bridge. It's Night Strike, and they have like a bunch of things for the homeless. Like they can get their hair cut or their feet washed, and they have food for them and a food closet and a clothing closet. So our job, our team, was to just go and talk to homeless people, build relationships with them. I was paired with Will, and I saw this girl sitting on the ground, and I had seen her earlier in the week, so I was like, okay, I'll go start a conversation with her. And she seemed kind of off when I first started talking to her, but then she was reading a book about Jonah in the Bible. So that, like, started our conversation about God, and I asked her if she felt like God had ever spoken to her, and she was like, oh, yes, and she, like, went into this whole story, and she said that God told her to, like, tie her shoelaces into a bunch of knots, and then she was like, it was in a giant knot, and God told her to try to untie it, and she couldn't untie it, and then she said she heard God tell her, if you can't untie these knots without me, how do you expect to, like, unfurl the mysteries of the universe? Like, those were the words she used. I was like, oh, my goodness. So it kind of just, like, opened my eyes to see that God can speak to anybody no matter where they are, if they're going to church or if they're living on the street. So I thought that was pretty awesome. Who is next?
Jet's also going to share about a Night Strike experience.
Okay, yeah. We started off Night Strike. It was really cool because there's like 100 volunteers and there's like 300 homeless people there. So it's a big, big event. And me and Emma got to talk to this girl. She was 32 years old. And you always wonder, like, why are you homeless? And this girl kind of, like, basically unfolded why she was homeless to us. And it's just a bad case of just events. She had no family. Both her parents had died. She was in an abusive relationship with her husband for 8 years. She had a 6-year-old, a miscarriage, and then she just had another baby who's now, like, 8 months. And she ran away, I guess, from that relationship. And she took her 8-month-year-old, and then she had that 8-month-year-old adopted to a Christian family. She had nowhere to live. Her car got stolen. She went to the hospital because she had breast cancer. She had stage 4. She's going to die in, like, 3 years. And it was really cool because she was really scared about, like, what's to come next. And she started talking to me about it, and she's like, yeah, I just hope, like, a cure comes out or something where I don't have to die. I'm like, well, yeah, that'd be nice. I do too, but you're still going to die. It's like, we're all going to die. And she's like, I'm scared. I don't have any answers. I was like, well, what if me and Emma, like, have an answer for you? And she was like, what? And she got really, really excited. So me and Emma basically got to unpack the gospel for her. We got to pray over her. And it was really cool because I've never done that before. So it was a really neat experience.
Coach Bullen.
Like some of the kids said, our ministry time is really intense in Portland. And one of the things that I believe that all of us took, this was my second year, and I think that everyone that went to Portland sees people in a different light now. No matter where they are, we're able to see people. And one of the things that happened to me that a lot of people in our group probably don't know, we played with children with the YMCA in the afternoons, and on the last day we were there, we showed up and we were so excited to just invest in these kids' lives on the last day, and they had a school circus because in Portland, circus is part of your curriculum or something. It's very strange. And we showed up, and it was like kind of a downer because we couldn't play with the kids and really just have fun with them. And we had to sit and watch this circus. And during the circus, one of the YMCA workers, her name was Roba, I had only spoken to her two or three times. She came and found me at the circus and sat by me and starts talking to me about her life. And so I said, well, where are you from? And she said, I was born and raised in Israel. And I was like, that's awesome. And I said, how is living there? And she said, well, I was born and raised in Jerusalem. And so I'm just kind of like, wow, this is cool. And she's like, I'm Arabic. So I'm like, wow, this is getting good. And she's like, and I'm a Muslim. I'm like, okay. And so on the inside, I'm like, okay, this is a God opportunity. Like, how often do Muslims come and talk to me? Not very often. And so on the inside, I'm like, okay, Holy Spirit, help me. I mean, what do I need to say? So I just felt like so much compassion and love. And during the circus, this young woman starts telling me how Christians have been so ugly to her and just how she's felt so persecuted. And she really believed in God, but the way she was treated her whole life as a Muslim living in Jerusalem, that she didn't want to be a Christian. Because if that's what Christians were, she didn't want to do it. So we have this 45-minute talk. She lets me pray for her. And I got to pray for a Muslim, which, being in ministry my whole life, that's something that I was never able to do. And it was so cool. And I was like blown away. So I got up and went to the bathroom and I came back and Blake's like, come here. So I went over and he's like, what were y'all talking about? I'm like, you're not even going to believe this. So I tell him and he's like, I just thought y'all were like very passionate about education and you were talking about teaching. And I'm like, no, there was no teaching. It was all about the Lord. And I thought from that, like each one of us, no matter if you went to Portland or not, like we had this conversation, we are the salt and the light of the earth. And you shouldn't have to run around and screaming Jesus, and you shouldn't have to have a bumper sticker. People should just see the love of Christ. And I truly believe that this woman saw it in our students, and she saw the love. And whether she knew it was the Lord, our love was what brought her and was able to pray, and whether that planted a seed or eventually maybe she will give her heart to the Lord. But I believe that each one of these students had a part to play. So this is a great mission trip to go on. It's very intense, and it gets you out of your comfort zone. And I would encourage you to talk to each one of these students because, again, we didn't have enough time to share all the ministry that went on, but it was very incredible.
Thank you. It was a great trip, and I'm just going to, I'll close out. Why don't you guys have a seat? We're going to close out with one more short video, and I'll introduce it a little bit. But I really couldn't have asked for a better group. It was just a real privilege and honor to be able to serve along everybody. They had a great attitude the entire week. Nobody got homesick. Everybody was flexible when we had changes in schedule and things like that that tend to happen on missions trips. And they really just wanted opportunities to serve and do ministry, and they responded to the call. So if the parents are here, be proud of your kids because they did an outstanding job. The video that we're going to close up with, when we were at the Union Gospel Mission, they have a program called Life Change Program, and it is for men that are addicted to alcohol, drugs, and it's just kind of ruined their life, and they want to change. And it's voluntary. They say they fill out an application, but once they're there, they cannot leave. It's kind of their whole world is within that Union Gospel Mission. And there's a gentleman by the name of Eric that found me when we were volunteering there and said, I'm not great with words. This is what he said, and he self-described, I'm not great with words, but the Lord's given me the ability to write poetry. And I've written a poem about my experience and what the Lord's doing in my life. And he said, I'd like to share it with your kids. And so we were able to record that, and I asked him, can I share that in chapel? And he said, yes, please do. I want people to know. I want it to get out there and hear what the Lord is doing. So if it's queued up, we're going to do this, and then you're going to be dismissed. So let me pray, and then we'll watch this video and then go on to, I think it's study hall lunch now. Are we in the second period? We're right about study hall lunch. Second period. Let me clarify that one. It's second period. Heavenly Father, I thank you for the reports that we get today. We thank you for the opportunity to go and do your work and be salt and light to those that maybe don't know you and just build relationship. And the amazing thing is we go there to try and impact lives, but our lives are impacted, and that's just how the Holy Spirit works. You're just an amazing God, and we just thank you for the opportunity to be able to serve you and work for you, Lord. We pray this in Jesus' name. Amen.
Thank you, sir. My name is Eric. helping. I'm not a very good speaker, but I'm a better writer. So I wrote a little thing for you guys. It says, my name is Eric Helpin. I've had the opportunity to come here to the UGM and change my life. I have 259 days clean and sober from drugs and alcohol, and I was baptized right here at the mission back in November. I've recently felt compelled to use this blessing as my testimony for Christ. I've not only changed the direction my life was going, I've also recently began changing and transforming my talents and passions. I've always loved to write poetry, and I've found that God can use this too. I've written this poem specifically for the younger generation, for you guys, and I pray that it will enlighten, or if nothing else, inspire you to continue or to begin offering your talents and passions to God to be used for His glory. And this is the poem. It says, if I could go back to when I was your age, okay. Now I know that statement sounds cliche, but trust me, I would have never even touched drugs in the first place. It's just a weird way to appreciate what love means. It's been ugly. Ever since I did, it's been bumpy. I've hurt myself and all those that love me. It's disgusting to think I needed a drink of something that messed me up just so I can get up in the morning. I'd ignore things important and distort dreams. Then the courts came, the criminal convictions. I quit all sports and closed all doors except those that absorbed me, my addictions. I not only skipped class, I quit class. There's no classiness in ripped pants, torn shirts and lips smashed, drunk passed out next to a tip glass. It's nastiness and sickness. I'll skip back like whiplash to an age of a young scene, drunk, smashed in the driver's side of my life's front seat. I collided with danger signs and made a kid who's now 16. That's when I was 16. She lived somewhere in the distance. Her whole childhood, I missed it. And that's ridiculousness. I understand now, but back then, I didn't. Forget this. The infamous words I'd say to finish each sentence, the difference is that I haven't been able to forget this. I'm forced each day to relive this mess. It's senseless to even consider commitments. I was already committed to my addictions, taken. Every day was a painful mistake / Vegas vacation, a gamble for change that didn't make sense. A sample of grace came when I was wasted once. I flipped the car into a lake and escaped the fun. I guess I hit the brakes and spun. It made me reevaluate and consider the love for my son. I need you, Father. Same thing, I was on my knees praying later. He's 6 years old. You see, God switched my soul. I ditched the victim role and got saved, literally. He's lit my glow, gifted me with the gift that's gold. It's the gift to know Christ lives in me. Spiritually, I'm different, and trust me, this is everything. Just believe, He's just as real as the wind that you cannot see. He's omniscient and knew that to you I'd speak. Omnipotent and powerful enough to move me to this place, to this speech, to this presentation, and to this lesson I pray will teach. If it wasn't for Him, your eyes wouldn't blink. You couldn't speak, just think. If you couldn't breathe, you wouldn't think about anything but oxygen. But then again, you couldn't even think if it wasn't for Him. Please rethink any sin that lurks within. Breathe in deep with what He gives. Help the less fortunate of your friends. Continue to let your life choices reflect a Christian existence. Be a witness for Him, just by the way that you live, and stay consistent with these commitments. Recognize what you've been given, and extend a hand to those lost in addictions. Be careful that you don't slip into the same temptations. It's biblical descriptions and some principles of Scripture that I've right here written. Let God and the Bible refill your vital life prescriptions. Let your mind's light bulb brighten another's life. And remember, Christ died for you and I, so why not live this life as Christians?
Okay, you are dismissed to go to second period.